Okay, so that's my opening line every time. Okay, so, all right. So there, I changed it. I had a few things. I'm like, I don't know if I want to like do this on a regular basis, but what happens is the weekend happens and I kind of separate from Facebook and Minds and all the things that I'm on. And, you know, the weekly routine is different because it's the weekend. And so I don't always get out as much of the things that I'm thinking at the time. And so I may kind of start this series where it's like salty review and weekend in review or something like that. I don't know. We'll see. I always have these great ideas, and then, you know, actually doing them all the time is another thing altogether. So anyway, for the moment, I just have these kind of experiences that built up over the weekend that I want to talk about, both personal and in, you know, in the political stuff that's going on at the same time. So the first one was the other day I was standing in a grocery line. This is my grocery shopping weekend. So the two stories that are personal I have, they're, you know, all related to shopping. So I was out shopping and grocery shopping. And I was at the grocery store that I stop and get my bread and produce-y type things. But I wasn't ready to get produce-y stuff because I had the produce stuff that I needed for the upcoming meals. So I'll get that next weekend. But I had to stop and get all my bread stuff. So I had this like, I had like 3 loaves of bread and hot dog buns and a hot dog package and then like a cake roll because it was dessert night. So it was, I was going to do hot dogs for dinner and cake roll for dessert while we watch a movie together. So that's our Saturday night thing. So I had, you know, but a big, big lot of bread. And the guy ahead of me was a Gen Xer. No, not a Gen Xer. I'm a Gen Xer. He was a millennial. He was younger than me and I'm on the tail end of Gen X. So anybody who's noticeably younger than me is a millennial or, you know, the next generation after that. So he, you know, millennial up ahead of me, and he kind of turns around and he says, oh, you know, so you're, you know, stocking up on bread, are you? And I was like, I said, no, this is my bread stop. And this is the store I get my bread at. And then I showed him my grocery list. And my grocery list I made up a couple of years ago. It has the 4 stops that I make. I go to 4 different stores and I know what things I need to get each store. So it has a column for each store and I put the items underneath the appropriate column. And he's like, oh, wow, you have that separated out by store. And I said, well, yeah, I said, we're a 1-income family and I have to make, you know, my husband makes some money and I spend it wisely. And he kind of joked and he was like, yeah, I make the money, but my wife doesn't spend it wisely. I'm like, well, something you're going to work on. So then we kind of chit chatted back and forth, just a little bit small talk. And then he said, yeah, she stays home. We have 3 children. I said, oh, we have 3 children too. And I said, and I homeschool them. So, you know, we have to, you know, incur that cost as well. And he was like, you know, he got ready to say this grand thing of in support of homeschooling. And you can just tell, you know, at this point, it's been 7 years of homeschooling. I know what's about roughly what is about to come out of people's mouths when they, you know, their continents changed one way or the other when I say we're homeschoolers. So he's about to say something supportive. And what he says is that, you know, I've always thought that homeschoolers ought to receive a stipend from the government or a voucher or something like that for the schooling, their efforts and stuff like that. And I was like, no, no, just like that. I was like, no, because I'm really animated. And I was like, no, 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 because the moment I take a tax break or a voucher or any money for the government for my homeschooling is the same exact moment that the government gets to regulate my homeschooling experience with my children. And I was like, no, I'd rather not. I'm happy to pay for public school. I'd rather not have the government up in my business. And at this moment, so this millennial is getting the Gen Xer response, and the guy behind me is either on the early end of Gen X or the late end of baby boomers. And it's funny because I didn't turn around and really look at him, but I could see out of the corner of my eye that there was just this big old smile on his face when I said what I said. And he's just like, and so the kid just didn't quite get the thought. And he's just like, you know, the same thing with moms. I always thought that moms should get some money for the government for staying home with the kids. He's like, I'm out earning money and you guys stay home with the kids all day and don't get anything. And I'm like, oh, no, no, no. I get paid in love, hugs, and kisses, and, you know, and the government is not all up in my business. And so, you know, and that was a good little interaction. It was funny. It was light, but really kind of hope that this millennial kid, and I can say he's a kid because he's a whole different generation from me, even if he is only probably 5-10 years younger than me at the most, hope this kid goes home and thinks about it. Just no, you people don't understand. You people don't understand. The moment the government pays you is the moment the government gets to tell you what to do, because they're giving you the money of the people. So the government gets to tell things that they give the money of the people to what to do, because they're giving you money that's not yours, which is what taxes are. Ugh. And so, you know, it was good, lighthearted, happy little, you know, in real life experience. But hopefully this kid will go home and realize, no, I don't, you know, hopefully I just jog something in him that will say, oh, you know, I'm like, I would rather be dirt poor paying for your public school kid experience and have the government out of my business than to get money from the government and have the government regulating my homeschool. Oh, okay. And there's that. Okay. Second experience. I was, again, after church, I dropped the kids and the man off at home and just went right back out the door because I'm like, I'm in the mood, I'm ready to go get this done, I need to get it done. So I dropped them off, turned right around, went right back out the door. After the first stop, I was like, oh, now I need lunch. So I went and stopped and grabbed something quick, and I was sitting in the parking lot of the place I was going to next. And I was eating my lunch, and I looked out through my car window, and I was in this lane. There was a lane, you know, like a parking lot space ahead of that, and then the one after that was where this kid was, and he was acting sketchy. He was walking around where the cars were, and he's kind of looking to see if anybody's looking, and I'm like, okay, you're acting sketchy. I'm not going to go all crazy here, but I'm going to keep an eye on you. And so I was watching him, and he caught sight of me watching him. And it was a couple of looking back at me and then continuing to look around. And he could have been just looking for a lost car, but it seemed sketchy to me. So I'm just, you know, as a good citizen, just keeping my eye out, just kind of looking to see if it's going to turn into anything that's not good. So he looked back at me, looked, you know, around again, and then kind of scooted. So it wasn't an immediate, like, noticing me and then moving away. And in that moment, after the first time he noticed me looking at him, I, you know, just kind of had this thought, he's black. You know what I mean? And it wasn't the immediate thought. He was just being sketchy immediately. But then I was like, oh, he's black. And then I did quick self-evaluation. Am I looking at this kid and being suspicious simply because he's black? And then I thought of two other incidences since moving to the city where I've done the same thing. I've sat and watched kids acting suspicious around other vehicles in parking lots. And both other times the kids were white. In fact, one of the times the kids were acting so sketchy that when I left the driveway, I called the cops and said, you may want to go check out this parking lot. There are some kids hanging around and they don't seem like they're up to anything good. And so, so I know that it had nothing to do with his race. It had to do with the fact that he was acting sketchy. And so, you know, and so self-evaluation, no, I'm not being racist. It's all good. I'm just, you know, being a good citizen, keeping my eyes out. And some people may feel like that's ageist or something, like I'm, you know, prejudiced against kids or that I'm being too busybody. Well, that's debatable for another thing. But the issue of racism, no, I'm not being racist. I do this equal opportunity busybody. And so, so looking at the kid. So anyway, he kind of walks away and eventually kind of walks away and goes someplace else and out of my sight. I can't see him, so I don't know where else, and I didn't follow him. I'm like, I'm just going to watch where I am. And after that, it's your business and somebody else's job to watch you. So he walked away, and I had this moment of like wondering if he was going to walk away thinking that I was looking at him because he's black, and like carry that as a chip on his shoulder and validation You know, is he one of these black kids who's got a chip on his shoulder and believes all white people are racist and out to get him? And I just made it worse by looking at him. And I'm like, and then there's just this instant moment of clarity. And I'm saying this internal process out loud because I think this is the problem going on right now. Is I think that there are a lot of people with all this crap bearing down on them, externally bearing down on them. You're racist. And all white people are bad, and white privilege, and microaggressions, and was it implicit bias, and all this other crap. It's crap, crap, crap. And this is why racial relations are bad right now, because it causes all of us to have this internal dialogue all the time about everybody we meet of the opposite color. So I'm having this thought process about this kid, and I realize, I'm like, you know what? It doesn't matter. And I have this kind of general sense anyway. It's the wonderful thing about being 40 years old. At this point, I don't care. You all can kiss my butt. I don't care what you're feeling. Get over your feelings. They're yours. They're not my problem. And so looking at this kid going, you know what? It doesn't matter how he feels, what he thinks walking away from this situation. I'm going to do what I think is the right thing to do. And it had nothing to do with racism. I know that inside of me. And if he wants to interpret it as racism, that's him and his problem and his emotions and the things he needs to get over. And he needs to have this idea inside of him where he checks himself and says, you know, is she looking at me? Does, you know, if he wasn't there doing anything nefarious, he needs to say, is there another reason why she might be looking at me? Oh, maybe she thinks I'm up to no good. And is it because I'm black? Or maybe it could be because I'm hanging around a car and looking each way to see if anybody's around. And you know what I mean? He needs to have the internal dialogue that gives me the benefit of the doubt. And I need to have the internal dialogue that doesn't look at him and say, oh, black, you're the worst person on the planet. I'm going to watch you simply because you're black. You know what I mean? And so each of us has to have the internal dialogue that gives the other person the benefit of the doubt. And you can't know what the other person is thinking. He can't know what was in my head unless he came over and asked me. And you know, let's see how that went. But not people don't do that. So he can't know what I'm thinking. So he's responsible for managing his emotions and in his internal thoughts and what he's experiencing. And it's not my fault that he was born black. And it's not my fault if there is any struggle there. And there might not have been any struggle. He might have been totally fine. But it's this idea that he could have been, you know, oh my gosh, I was looking at him. And maybe that walked, helped validate the chip on his shoulder if there was one. And I don't, that's not my responsibility. And this is the thing with the Black Lives Matter movement. It's not my responsibility how you feel, black people. It's not. I'm going to not be racist. And I'm going to treat you how I treat you, or treat you how I treat everybody. And you're going to think what you're going to think, and it's not my problem. And no, I'm not putting money in an account for reparations. You can kiss my donkey over that. All right, so anyway, there was my nice little Black Lives Matter moment, and I just thought I'd say it out loud because I think those things are that internal struggle. I think it's important to say it out loud and have it out there because who knows, there might be somebody else who's kind of like, oh my gosh, that was totally my experience the other day, and you just need to know that somebody else is thinking things through too. All right, anyway, next thing, the Women's March. Oh my gosh. I've been ranting and raving all day, and I have been a little keyboard warrior all day long because, okay, the Women's March doesn't make me mad. I don't care that people are marching and protesting. I don't. It doesn't make me mad. It makes me, I don't want to say worried for the state of our country. Just flabbergasted, I think is the right word. It's just flabbergasted. I've been using that word a lot because I think that's just kind of generally my life. And when I look at things outside of our four walls, I never want to leave our house because I'm like, oh my gosh, people are nuts. And so Women's March, absolutely flabbergasted over these people. Absolutely. There's been this thing going around Facebook that I really love. And it's somebody wrote it up. It was really well written. And it's for the women to share who weren't involved in the Women's March, didn't care to be involved in the Women's March, thought it was silly, and wanted to say so. And it's just this really well-written thing that's been circulated. I had two friends that came through, and I'm sure that if I had those two friends, I know other people are sharing it all over. So it kind of went around, and Underneath there are these women who are part of it, arguing with the thought that was communicated. I'm like, you know what? As women, we actually get to say out loud an opinion that's different than yours, you know, and you should be championing that because we're women voicing our opinions. So anyway, and you know, and the way to champion that, I guess, is to tell you that you shouldn't be upset about the women's marches because women's activism is the reason you have the right to object openly because women were not allowed to talk before feminism. Oh, it's just, they make it so easy to mock. I just had a field day on one of them, and it was really, I mean, I really was kind of mean a little bit, but it was just, it's just too easy. And on the other hand, it's just flabbergasting. Okay, so this is my thing. All right. I was trying to describe to my husband today, when I look at the Women's March, okay, Sargon made a really good video where he covers interviewing women who were marching in England, which, you know, the globalism behind this is ridiculous, and it's another whole subject altogether. But interviewing these women in England, and some of them didn't even know, couldn't even give a knowledgeable answer to why they were protesting. And a lot of the other ones had, like, you know, this one gave this reason, and the next one gave a totally separate reason, and the next one gave another reason after that, and then and there's, like, all these reasons, so that there's no continuity. These women don't know. This is my thing. This is what's driving me nuts about the women's march. They don't know why they're doing it. They don't know. They don't know why they're doing it, what they're trying to accomplish, who's running it, what the motivation is behind it, what the agenda is behind it. They don't know. They're anti-feminist. They're feminists being anti-feminist because they're out there being emotionally whipped up and protesting nothing. Nothing. Our rights are not being violated in any way, shape, or form. Our rights are not under attack. There is no attack on women in this country. There is none. It's ridiculousness. Shh. No more talking. Don't want to hear it anymore. You people are dumb. Dumb, 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 dumb. And there's no attack. Our rights are totally fine. I'm making this video. I'm going to put it on YouTube. And except for the fact that I'm coming from a conservative viewpoint bashing progressivism, there's no reason that the YouTube is going to take this down that has anything related to my vagina. And we are fine. Wage gap is a myth. Abortion, like in that video, said a number of times in a number of places, even mainstream media outlets have said that abortion is not under attack, even if somehow the very remote chance that it got Roe v. Wade got overturned on a federal level, it then becomes a state's rights issue, and most states have overturned their abortion prohibitive laws. The only thing that's under attack here is Planned Parenthood's budget, and that it's not going to get, hopefully, Lord willing, will not get any more of our taxpayer money given to it. That's it. That's it. The number one partner and the number one donator to the Women's March movement is Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood just literally whipped up a country filled or capitalized, at the very least, and global thing so that it could throw a nationwide hissy fit about being having its taxpayer money taken away from its budget. Okay. When you protest for nothing, for no good reason, and, you know, constitutionally, I mean, you have a right to protest. You have a right to protest over the stupidest nothingness that you want to protest. You have a right to protest anything you want. But under the Constitution, the First Amendment, we gather together to petition the government for a redress of grievances. There have to be grievances in order for something to be redressed. Redressed. Dressed again. Addressed again. Okay? So, for instance, there's a pro-life march on Washington coming up on Friday. That, I think it's March for Life, coming up on Friday. That is people petitioning the government for a readdressing of a grievance. The grievance is abortion, because it's grievous to a lot of people, good near half the country. And they're petitioning the government for a redress of something that exists that needs to be readdressed. Women's March is just a bunch of whiny women mad about Trump winning. There is nothing under attack. There's nothing under attack. Certainly none of our rights that are of the inalienable or equality basis. None of those are under attack. There's nothing coming from Washington. No one anywhere ever is saying women should be barefoot and pregnant and not vote and never leave the home and have no rights. That does not exist. Our rights are not under attack. It's unbelievable to me. And then, of course, it's been co-opted by the globalists, and the evidence of that is all the other ridiculous progressive talking points that are the global agenda and that don't have anything to do with women's rights. But anyway, I digress. That's another whole subject. Blah, blah, blah. We'll leave that. I'm not going to address it. So there's this feeling of, like, when you go to protest, especially something that's nationwide and covered in the media like it is, when you don't protest anything real, you cheapen the poignancy of protesting. You cheapen it. You make it a joke. You make it a joke. You people made protesting mockworthy this weekend. Mockworthy. And you made feminism mockworthy because you women don't even know why you're doing what you're doing. You don't know. You got emotionally whipped up. You're having an emotional temper tantrum. You're not thinking rationally or logically about the reasoning behind what's going on. You're not thinking at all. You're running on emotion. You are the reason women are oppressed. Because men look at that and they go, oh my gosh, let that run the country? Ha ha ha, no thanks. Okay, you women are the stereotype for why women get oppressed. Gah, unbelievable. Yeah. I tried to liken this. I'm still coming at a loss for words. I really work best when I can give an analogy to something that makes it clear to me, and I hope it makes it clear to other people. And I'm trying to explain to my husband the feeling I'm having watching the protest stuff. And what it made me think of was when I went to Bible school in Canada. I studied the Bible in Christian ministry for 3 years in Canada after high school. It was a 3-year program. And one of the years, and I think it was our senior year, this guy came in, and I don't know if it was a chapel speaker or if it was a conference speaker, and he was really vague. The message he gave was really vague. And then he gave an altar call at the end. And this is what woke me up to altar calls. I'm like, I'd never do altar calls. Even if I feel like I have a reason to go for it, I never do altar calls anymore because of this guy. And I'm so thankful for it, actually, because it really kind of woke me up to that nonsense. It's not even biblical. It's nonsense. Yes, it's nonsense. And I don't care if that hurts your feelings. The altar call, he gave this altar call, and it was so vague, it was completely vague, that everybody, the entire student body, but me and one other girl, went forward. And I didn't go forward because I didn't know what I was going to be going forward for. And first of all, that speaks to who I am, which is why I'm looking at this nonsense going on and saying, you guys don't even know what you're doing. I've seen this before. And I know what this is. You don't even know what's going on. You don't even know what you're protesting. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's insanity. And so the whole student body went forward, and me and this other girl, and that pressure to go forward was intense, because who wants to be the only two people not going forward on a spiritual call? And I sat there and I did not go forward. And it was because I didn't know what I would be going forward for, because it was so vague and so all-encompassing that I'm like, this isn't worth my emotions. I don't know what I'm going to be doing or accomplishing with this action. And And then like 2 weeks later in class, the teachers, the instructors, because this was somebody not from the college, it was somebody from away, the instructors must have had a discussion about it, or at least this one in particular must have really realized the nonsense that happened that day. Because about 2 weeks later, or well, maybe not about 2 weeks later, maybe it was only a couple of days later, because he said, it was 2 weeks that he said in his response, he said to the class, he said, you know, the real test of going forward on an altar call is not in that moment where you're having that emotional experience, but in whether or not what you went forward for is still a part of your life 2 weeks later, if you're still working on it 2 weeks later. And I will never forget that. I mean, that was, when did I graduate? 2000. I mean, that was 17 years ago, and I will never forget. I will never forget. And I've not gone forward. I maybe one or two other times since, but I've not gone forward to any altar calls, and I don't do it because it's unbiblical. It's not even in the Bible. It's garbage. And it's based on, it's based on emotion, and I can make a decision in my seat that I need to work on something in my life without going forward. And the proof in the pudding is not whether I went forward in an emotional state, but whether or not I'm still working on it 2 weeks later, unless that lesson, that decision in that moment is still making an impact in my life 2 weeks later, 2 months later, 2 years later. And so it really helped kind of, it was like a really good experience for me. And I'm watching these women, I'm watching women all over the country, but instead of the entire student body, half the country just participated in something and they don't even know why they're doing it. Some people know why they're doing it. The people who are there with an agenda know why they're doing it. but so many of the women don't know why they're doing it. It was an emotional experience. They were mad about Trump getting into office. They didn't like it. They didn't like his rhetoric. And it was emotions. It was all emotions and no thought. You don't know what this, half of them don't even know that there was something going on in other parts of the country and other parts of the world. A number of them don't know who's running it, don't know who's behind it, what the purpose of it is, what they're hoping to accomplish, why they were even there. That troubles me. That troubles me that a protest that would get so much attention and garner so much support. In my state, Maine, I think there were like 6 or 7 gatherings, marches, women's marches in like 6 or 7 different towns. And I'm sure it was like that all the way across the country. Women not even knowing what they're doing and what they're hoping to accomplish. Just going out because feels. I just... Ugh. And I'm not even sure that illustration encapsulates the feeling of just flabbergast. And I almost want to cry. How lost we are as a society that women can go get worked up like this. As a society, we're running so much on emotion right now, that we take the time and the money to get passionate enough to go protest. And let's be honest, the fact that we don't like who the president is, that's what it is for most of the women who went. The people organizing it have an agenda. The people who went supporting the different partners of the Women's March have an agenda. They know what they're doing. But all these other women who were just there to participate, useful idiots. And I said those things today and I got, oh, you're being mean and offensive and hurtful. And I'm like, I don't care. I don't care anymore. I want to be a nice person and a kind person, but I literally cannot. I cannot do it. I cannot be nice about this because you didn't go to accomplish anything. You did to throw a temper tantrum. And it's so hurtful to the cause, to actual causes that people actually should be marching for. It's hurtful to feminism. And I'm not a feminist at all. I'm not a third wave, second wave, and I'm barely a first wave. I kind of like the right to vote, but I look at how women vote nationally and I go, I don't know that that's really such a good thing. I'm not a feminist at all, at all. I rather enjoy being barefoot and pregnant in the kitchen. I can't wait to be pregnant again and I'm 40. gonna pop out one more before I lose that ability. And I'm not a feminist at all. So, you know, that can be, you can point at me and say, oh, you're not a feminist. So yes, that would be true. I am not at all. And you're so mean and you're so hurtful and, calling us stupid, cheap. And I don't know what else to do at this point. I mean, I can't even sit there and say, you know, you have so much hatred for your fellow man that you can't even understand. I understand that you guys don't understand what you're doing. And I have to say, that's insanity. You people are sheep. You're being stupid. Because there is no other way to look at this. I don't care what a lovely experience some of you had. I don't care that when you got there, you heard inspiring speeches. I don't care that you think you're doing something for humanity rights and immigrant rights and all that. I don't care. You people are dumb. You're dumb. You're dumb. You got whipped into an emotional frenzy and you went and did this and it's dumb. Not only that, but the evidence of all these things other than actual women's issues, because when you look at women's issues, there was absolutely no reason to protest because none of them are under attack. But other than that, looking at all the other issues and the fact that the number two partner to the women's marches is an environmental group, and you look at the other things, kind of talking points, minorities, the fact that the white woman was the one who kind of started out spearheading it, and then she was pressured to step down. And then the number of white women who were planning on going to be a part of it and who were told either implied or told outright that they weren't welcome because they were white. And then the women who wanted to go stand as general feminists and stand against Trump, but are pro-life, wanted to go. They were told they were not welcome and ignored. And when you look at, and then all the other issues that are the standard globalist talking points, I had this like real moment of clarity in typing things out today. I'm like, and I know this, but I had this like concise way of saying it. This started as a women's issues thing. That really didn't have any validity to it. It would not take very long for the rest of the country to look at that and say, they aren't under attack yet. And it doesn't look like they're going to be under attack. You don't actually have a valid reason to be all worked up. So instead, it got co-opted. In the space of 2 months, it went from a Facebook post the day after the election. And we're supposed to believe these people, the majority of them, can't find their way out of a brown paper bag and lose their keys every other day. We're supposed to believe that these people, grassroots efforts only, managed to create a global organization in 2.5 months. Grassroots. I think we really are. I think we really have lost our minds. I think we're really not capable of thinking anymore. It's really disturbing to me. So in the space of 2.5 months, this is now a global organization, a global effort with a national and an international global council and all these people working to make this happen. Lots of deep pockets came out because you think about the porta potties alone at each one of these locations. That was a good cost of money right there. Just, And so all these issues and all the talking points are all the same talking points that BLM got co-opted with. BLM met with the president. All of a sudden on their webpage, they have these list of demands and all these things they want to have happen. And all of them are global issues seen through the black eyeglasses. And now this movement has been co-opted. All of the issues that are being talked about are all the same talking points. They're all the same progressive globalist talking points. All the things that are the goals of the sustainable development, SDGs for the UN. All of these things are the same talking points in all of these groups because divide and conquer. I had this moment of clarity of looking at it. I'm like, this is the conquering part. The divided part was to section off the black people and get them all riled up, and section off the women and get them all riled up, and then to superimpose the values of progressive globalism. And then you've created a black army thinking it's fighting for black issues, but it's really just fighting for globalism. And then you've created a nice little woman army thinking that they're fighting for women's issues, but they're really just fighting for globalism. All of the same talking points, all of the same concerns, all of the same progressive globalist jargon on both groups, except that they twist it in the BLM to look like it's black issues, and then they just twist it in the women's group to make it look like they're women's issues. If you go to the, it was Planned Parenthood and the NRDC, I think is the initials, you can find it on the Women's March page, or the two top partners. You go to the NRDC, and it's environmentalism that impacts females, women, over the world. So it's how the climate change problems specifically impact women. Just like, gush, gush, gush. You just want to bang your head against the table. You know, and so globalists have co-opted both of those movements. And all of the issues, all of the things that they're demanding, all the things that they care about, all the things that they're talking about are all the same things. They're just slanted to make it look like it's a woman's issue and slanted to make it look like it's a black issue. And you just look at this, I really feel like when I see the sheer size, the sheer number of the marches that went on from coast all the way across the country to coast, the sheer amount of women who are doing stuff that they don't know why they're doing it and they don't know what they're actually accomplishing, it makes me feel faint in my heart. And it makes me feel like, oh my gosh, why are we even bothering? Why? We got a nice little army of black people fighting for globalism. We have a nice little army of women fighting for globalism. And the sheer number that turned out without even knowing why they're going forward. You went forward to an altar call, ladies. You're having a nice emotional experience compared to a spiritual experience, but it's the same damn thing. Instead of emotions and spiritual, you're having your emotions and you're going forward to activate something you know not what you do. You know, I mean, I guess I should forgive. That's Jesus's words. Forgive them for they know not what they do. So I guess I should try to forgive. But it's not even a matter of forgive. It just wants to shake the crap out of people and just go, wake up! Gah! And that's been my theme all day. In fact, I did it on another friend's page and just dropped all my links and dropped all my stuff. And she wrote me and said, you're hilarious, thanks. And I was something like that. And I was like, yeah. We're either going to wake them up or shut them up, because I can't be nice about this. I can't be nice about this. You people went forward for an altar call that you know you don't even know why you went forward. All right, that's 38 minutes of me losing my stuff, and that's about as much as I can do. But and that's about as much as any of you can tolerate, I'm sure. So anyway, just needed to get that out. Hope this is entertaining, if nothing else. And enjoy your nights and on with our week. Yay.